We live in a very vibrant, exciting city, those of us who live in Austin. And I want you to think for a little bit about what you would do if you had the opportunity to take a time machine and go back a quarter of a century, back to Austin in 1990, and how you would advise the city of Austin, the city council of Austin. And it's hard to imagine today, but there was a raging debate going on at the time. And it was basically the divide was between people who thought that we were going to have a real problem in the future with stimulating economic growth and not having enough people in Austin. And people, so economic development and population growth were going to be our real problems in 25 years. Or that in terms of not having enough of them, or that we really needed to spend more time thinking about actually having protecting our water supply, protecting our resources that would be necessary to accommodate the what appeared to be the rapid population growth that was coming. And that we also needed to think about, while we had all this growth, increasing our green spaces and our parks and our wild areas. So if you were going to go back 25 years ago, which of those two sides would you have thought about advising the city council on? If you said you really thought we needed more population growth, then I can't really imagine how much population growth you really wanted to have, because Austin was less than a quarter of the population then that it is now. We've had remarkable population growth, 2 million people in population, and we're one of the fastest growing parts of the country. And so clearly we've had enormous population growth, and population growth has some constraints and problems, and especially the natural resources that are necessary to support a city of this size become problematic. And especially in a dry area like Texas, the water supply. We do have these recurring water shortages. We just came out of a big drought. We're now in a very wet area. And that kind of La Nina to El Nino cycle on about a 3 to 5 year cycle is something we've experienced for as far back as their records. And so we're going to continue to have these water shortages. And so even though our water is quite abundant right now, very shortly we'll go back into another drought, almost certainly, and we'll be right back where we were just the worries that we had just a year or two ago when we were all worried about where our water is going to be coming from. It's not just a wonder in terms of the water and the springs and the making a great place for humans to live, but many of those same elements, the diversity of the habitats, the water, the springs, make it a wonderful place for all kinds of diverse plants and animals to live. And so this region of the spring region right along the edge of the Edwards Plateau is a huge biodiversity hotspot. And there's all kinds of species of many different groups of organisms that are found here and no place else in the world. So it happens to be kind of a perfect storm in terms of thinking about protection, because these are rare organisms that only live in a little place, and it's also they're living right where the humans want to live. And so obviously there's lots of development. And so the first thing we had to do was to think about how we would manage to get the public excited about these salamanders living in their springs. And so we started a campaign with lots of different help from different groups, and we got graphics artists to design frisbees of Barton Springs salamanders and t-shirts and all kinds of other things. And this frisbee is from, this is 30 years ago we had this. And in preparing the talk, I actually was able to find one remaining copy of this Frisbee. And so I am going to give this out today with the help from a little bit of assistance. So if I can get you to come up, please. This is a member of Austin's only, of its professional ultimate team, the Austin Soul. And what's your name?
Eric Hillis.
So yeah, the same last name.
We did. What a coincidence.
How about that? So if somebody who's under 18 can answer the following question. All right, so if you can, I want you to stand up and let me see you out there. So the question is, what is the scientific name of the Barton Springs salamander? Anybody? No? Oh, you got it? Okay, stand out in the aisle and shout it out. Come here. What's the answer? Very good. Rhesus sosorum. Excellent. No, wait a minute. You're not done yet. So, stay out in the aisle. Stay out in the aisle. And you're going to, can you catch the frisbee here? All right. We get it from the Austin Soul. Here it comes.
You ready?
Right? Ready? Oh! I guess. All right, turn the lights back on. I guess we didn't quite have a level playing field there. Now, the 80s end and we got into the 90s, and citizens became very interested and involved and active about protecting the springs. And so Save Our Springs Alliance has a display out here and has some of the same photographs. But in June of 1990, there was a city council meeting that lasted way into the night and into the early morning hours, where people stood up and protested about some development that was planned for Barton Creek that would severely impact the recharge, all the water that was coming down that would feed the aquifer that would come out of Barton Springs. And so as a result of that, hearing, the city heard the citizen input and blocked that particular proposal. Out of that excitement, the Save Our Springs Coalition, now I guess Save Our Springs Alliance, formed. And in addition, there was a formal proposal submitted by that coalition then to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife to list the Barton Springs salamanders endangered. Now, there was opposition to that as well. There were people who were claiming that if it were listed, it would be catastrophic to the economic development of Austin, and all population growth would cease, and the city would be a wasteland. So now we're proposing to do the most Texan thing ever. Go drilling for salamanders. And so we know where these occurred. We know where they were. Even if we don't actually hit salamanders, a geyser of salamanders, we're going to at least hit water, and we can take the water out and analyze the DNA and see if these salamanders are still down in there. So now we have lots of really interesting new technology and tools that we can use to study this fascinating biodiverse aquifer that's so important to all of our lives. All right, so question, have the salamanders done enough to save the humans of Austin? Well, first of all, give them a break. They're just salamanders, right? So they've done pretty much about all they can do. It's about time that humans step up and give them a little bit of a hand. And realize, though, that it's not humans versus salamanders. It's sometimes presented that way by people that want you to think that because they got some other stake in the game. But saving the salamanders means saving the humans. We need the same thing. We need to protect the water supply. All the salamanders need is the clean and abundant water that we need for our own survival. And not just salamanders and humans, there's an entire diverse community of organisms. The salamander is kind of just like the representative. It's like the most glamorous organism we could find in the aquifer to be able to protect it. So I'll finish off with this quote. It all boils down to this, that all life is interrelated. We're all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied into a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one destiny affects all indirectly. I think that's a beautiful quote. Anyone have any idea who said that? You do? Who said that?
Yogi Bear.
What's that?
Yogi Bear.
What did you say?
Yogi Bear.
Yogi Bear. No, great idea. Yogi Bear was a great idea, but Yogi Bear wasn't quite that articulate. It was actually Martin Luther King.